Hey guys, Ray from Love Your RV and Boat. So I'm back with you again to test out another one of these power station chargers for charging off your alternator in your vehicle. Now they do call them a charger, DC to DC alternator charger, but they're more of a DC to DC voltage converter. The actual charging takes place inside the power station. So it converts the voltage coming from your alternator, your vehicle battery, which is generally 12 volts, although it's capable of doing 24 volt systems too. And then it can step that voltage up between 15 and 60 volts for the output to go into a power station. Then inside the power station, there's a charger system in there to charge the battery bank in your power system. Anyway, it's capable of a maximum of 600 watts of charging power into the power station, depending on the voltage level you set. I think it has a default setting on the side here of 300 watts at 30 volts, but they have an app where you can adjust the settings. So this is from BougeRV. It's a newly released product from them. So they asked me if I would do a video for them. Fair disclaimer, this was sent out as a free review sample for me. What you get in the kit is the actual charger itself. So that would be mounted somewhere in the vehicle, pretty close to your power station. They give you a wire to hook up to the power station. The one that's included has this XT60 connector, which most power stations on the market use nowadays for their DC input for solar and DC. But there is, I think I saw on their website, they did have another cord that had a different optional connectors that fit other types of power stations, barrel connectors, that sort of thing. Then they also provide a 5 meter cable to go from your battery. You got a couple of ring connectors here, and you would wind that through your vehicle and then connect it to the power station or the DC to DC charger with these inputs that are already pre-done for you, pre-tinned. Quite nice. Reminds me of the Bluetti charger that I reviewed not long ago. It's like they're using similar type cable, 6 gauge, nice soft cable, probably pretty fine stranded wires as it's very flexible, so it's easy to wind through the vehicle. And we got a little bag of some screws and also a hex key wrench there for adjusting. Oh, sorry, the seagulls are having a blast here today. It's the noise you hear. So they did put a fuse in line on the power wire here, but they put it right near the end here that goes into the little box. So there's a lot of wiring between the battery and that fuse that is unprotected. I think it's a 60 amp fuse they used. So right away I responded to them and said they really need to say in the manual to tell people to put a fuse, terminal fuse, on the battery. And they actually said they're gonna look at including one in their kit. Because if you hook this to your battery in your vehicle, there's no protection all the way to this end. So you've probably got, you know, a good 15 feet of unprotected wire. If this wire were to get pinched against metal, you know, the chassis in your vehicle, you could get a short circuit with no protection. So you'd have your full battery power and that would overheat and melt that wiring and maybe cause a problem. So I told them about that and they said to mention that people should put some type of fusing on this end too. And another thing to mention is a lot of people, when I say, oh, this is a charger, they kind of think they'll be able to charge their RV battery, say their lithium battery or whatever, off it. But that is not what this box is about. It's for doing power stations. Just because the output voltage on this is between 15 and 60 volts, and it's not got a charger in it, so it's just a direct output voltage. So it's not really used for that type of application. Anyway, let's hook it up to the truck and we'll give it a test. I'll download the app and we'll have a look at that. So wiring hookup is pretty simple. On this end, you're going to put the wiring that goes to the battery, and then there's a plus and minus on the input there. So it would be red to plus and black to minus. In my case, I'm actually going to use a system I already have built into my truck. I have a plus and minus from the battery coming out here, and it's already threaded through my truck, so I won't go to the hassle of threading this all the way through. It's basically the same type of wire. And on the output here, we have the plug that came with the unit plugged into that with the MC4 connectors. And most power stations on the market, because their DC input is solar, almost all of them use MC4 connectors for their input, so you just connect those together and they'll feed the power out of here into your power station. And then I'll just show you how the wiring is done on my truck's battery. I have a Ram 3500 diesel truck. The connection here included a hex key here. Just unloosen it and then put the wires in and tighten it up. And then it has a little kind of dust cover there. This thing isn't waterproof or anything, so it has to be installed inside the vehicle somewhere dry. And then they usually want some space around it for cooling, because there's a small fan in here that cools it, draws air in and pushes air out. They also have a data port here. I think that's for doing firmware updates and things like that. So here's my engine bay, and here's the battery I'm connecting it to. And you can see I've already got a connection done for my existing wiring. Basically, I'm taking the red positive wiring and going to the positive post of the battery terminal. And you can see here what I'm talking about, a fuse. I have a terminal fuse here. My truck came with this spot to put a terminal fuse on. But you can also get aftermarket devices that are like a terminal block that you could put a fuse on. Anyway, that fuse protects that wiring in case it shorts out anywhere. It'll pop the fuse rather than overheating the wiring. And then there's the negative post. You put the other wire on like that and then thread it through whatever type of vehicle you have. Usually 5 meters is going to be enough. That's 16.5 feet. And they do have a nice cover here to keep the wires together to aid in that. Anyway, we'll fire up the truck. My wiring goes through the truck here and comes back on this port, because I have used DC to DC chargers for my RV batteries in the past. So I have this nice port set up for it. I thought I'd utilize that. Okay, so we turn it on. We got a green light here. I'm just going to set up the app. Use the BougeRV app, and it did a search and found DC600. So we'll just do a connection there. So you have other devices in the BougeRV ecosystem here, portable heater and air conditioner and stuff, but we'll just choose that. And we'll take a look at the screen here and do a recording for you. Okay, so kind of a nice screen showing start battery to the DC600 and then power station. Nothing's happening at the power station right now. Shows alternator voltage 12 volts and show you the output and the temperature of this. Charging open, so there's a thing to turn charging on and off, and then we have charging voltage, so you can set that to different things. It's like you have to disconnect the device, your open button, blah blah blah. You have to say yes. Yeah, there we go. So we can set different things. Select charging voltage. Let's go with 60 because mine can handle that. Okay, engine is on. Let's see, 14.4 volts coming in. It's got a little animated graphic there. I've set it to 60 volts for my charge voltage. So we're just going to turn that on. You can see you've got a flashing light here. And solid green, and I can hear the fan kicking on in here. My power station is lit up, should start charging pretty soon. There we go, starting to get some input wattage ramping up. Here we are, we're about 400 and 40 watts, which seems to be what this particular power station likes to level out at. So you might not always get 600 watts. It'll depend on your power station. Go over here, get some information. 60 volts, 400, and it's kind of bouncing around 440 watts. Input voltage 13.7 volts. There's some voltage drop between the battery and this box because I have, you know, about 25 feet of wiring going on. And then the little animation showing that it's going into the power station there. Yeah, solid green on that charge light there, and the other light is the power light. Seems to work pretty good. It's decided to plug in a heater into this power station just so it could go to full input here. And I can see 590 watts showing here. There's 600 watts and the amperage is 48 amps. So kind of give it its max wattage test there. We'll try changing the charging voltage here. So you can see that's the max. Let's just drop it down to its default here. I think it's 30. Confirm. Okay, there you go. So change to 30 volts. Now you can see it's putting about 300 watts out. So basically this thing always will put out 10 amps, and you're just varying the voltage from 15 to 60 volts to change the wattage that's going out. So you may want to do that if you want less, you know, load on your alternator, something like that. Looks like there's a fault screen. If anything goes wrong, it'll show up there. And we got a setup screen. You can change temperatures, Fahrenheit to Celsius. You can also change the minimum input voltage. It's set for 12.5, so you can adjust that if you don't want to be running down your battery. And there's your charging voltage and firmware. So yeah, minimum voltage, you can change it there and keep it quite high. So when you turn off the truck, then it'll turn off this unit. So we'll just set this at 13. Change it there. Now we'll turn off the truck and make sure that this unit turns off. Otherwise, it would run down your starter battery. There we go. So it turned off there. See alternator voltage once it dropped down below 13. So that's a good feature. Well, there you go. Seems to work as advertised. A couple other specs for you. They say when it's just sitting idle, it draws less than 50 milliamps, which is barely anything. So should be any problem with drawing your vehicle battery down just idling. And also its efficiency is greater than 95% as far as power loss in the conversion. Anyway, I saw some screws here, so I thought I'd just take it apart so we can get a peek inside at how it's built. There we go. It's four screws at each end. This is the input end. See where the 6-gauge wires go into those terminal blocks, so pretty beefy. This looks like it's probably maybe the Bluetooth. Kind of slides in there. Metal case to help with the cooling. And on this end we got the little fan and the output connector there. Anyway, nothing special, but they do have a 18-month warranty on it, so a little longer than a lot of the units that only give a 1-year warranty. And finally, I wanted to get a closer look at this fuse that they included in there. 60-amp fuse, kind of in line. Looks like kind of an oddball fuse. I don't really have ever seen one like that before, so it could be a problem if you did blow it and you were looking for a spare. Anyway, I think it would be better, like I said, to have the fuse at the battery end, not at the end close to the unit itself. Anyway, any questions, just leave them in the comments. Till next time, Ray from Love Your RV and Boat. Cheers, everyone.